Lovely people, welcome to my channel. Today, too, I'm here to give you a summary of our Sabbath school lessons, and we are in lesson 8, which talks about choose life. Please, if you have not yet subscribed, consider subscribing, like and share this video. You might touch a heart out there by just sharing this video. Let us pray. We thank you, our most gracious Father, for the opportunity to share your word. We pray that you give us an understanding and your Holy Spirit to guide and teach us, in Jesus' name. Amen. Our memory test is taken from Deuteronomy 30 verse 19. And I read, I call heaven and earth as witness today against you that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life that both you and your descendants may live. Amen. Therefore, choose life so that both you and descendants may live. This message was given to the Israelites, but today is for all of us because we too, we are spiritual Israelites. So this week, as we continue in Deuteronomy, we will look at the choice of life and the opportunity given us to choose life, to choose it on the terms that God, the giver and sustainer of life, has graciously offered. Amen. So God is calling us to choose life. And not just any life, but life that is based on Him. Sunday talks about the tree of life, the tree of life. And the Sunday lesson makes us understand that when God created everything perfectly in the Garden of Eden and brought Adam and Eve, none of them requested that God should create them. In fact, everything in this world never asked that God should bring them into existence. And so when we read Genesis 2 verse 8 and verse 9 and also verses 15 to 17, we see that it was God's own will to create everything in this world and also to create man and make man to take charge of everything. The lesson is pointing it to us that every other thing in this world exists. And so human beings, we do not just exist because stones, trees, they are all existing. But we have life. What we have is not just existence, it is life. And not just any life like animals here and there, but life that is based on God. And that life was created in the image and likeness of God. And also in Genesis 3 verse 22 and 23, we also see that when man fell, decided to go his own way, God quickly said, let us take the tree of life from there so that man will not eat the tree of life and stay alive for forever or live forever in sin. In the midst of Eden grew the tree of life, whose fruit had the power of perpetuating life. Had Adam remained obedient to God, he would have continued to enjoy free access to this tree and would have lived forever. But when he sinned, he was cut off from partaking of the tree of life, and he became subject to death. The divine sentence, as thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return, points to the utter extinction of life. Ellen G. White, The Great Controversy, page 532 and 533. So if man had chosen to obey God, there wouldn't be the need of we suffering and having to make another decision to choose life, because we'll have life in its abundance. Thus, right from the start, the Bible presents us with just one of two options: eternal life, which is what we were originally supposed to have, and eternal death, which in a sense is merely going back to the nothingness out of which we first came. And so God's initial option was what? Eternal life for us, but we chose the other way. But the good news is that the tree of life doesn't just end in Genesis. In Revelation, we are made to understand that we will eat the tree of life when we go to heaven. Meaning, if we choose now to have life in God and stay according to his principles, we will have life again. We are going to read Revelation 2 verse 7. And it reads, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Amen. And so if we decide to choose life today, in Christ, we will enjoy the fruit of life when we go to heaven. Monday talks about no middle ground, no middle ground. And the basic point is, there is no middle. You can't say, I am not on the side of God, neither am I on the side of Satan, I'm in the middle. It doesn't work like that. No. You are either with God or with Satan. So the lesson gave us some few Bible verses to read. And when you come to John 3:16, he said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son to the whole world. And whoever, whosoever believes. And so you see, underline the word believes there. If you believe, you have eternal life, which means if you don't believe, you will not have. So there's nothing like in the middle here. Romans 6:23 also makes us understand that for the wages of sin is what? It's death. But the gift of life is what? Through Jesus Christ, okay? It's either you are choosing life to remain in the gift of life that we have in Jesus Christ, or you choose sin, and then the wages will become what? Death. Then we have also Romans 8:6, which also makes us understand that in our carnality, carnal, everything carnal is what leads to death. The spirit, the spiritual things leads to what? To life. And so it also tells us that you cannot be carnal and say that, oh, the heart belongs to God. But as for the physical and everything that I do, it doesn't matter. No, it's either you are with God or you are not with God. When we come to 1 John 5:12, it also makes us understand that he who has Christ has life. Meaning, if you have Christ, you have life. If you don't have Christ, you don't have life. That is it. In the end, there is no middle ground for us human beings. Before the great controversy is completely over, sin, Satan, evil, disobedience, and rebellion will be eradicated. After that happens, each one of us individually will either have the life, the eternal life that God originally had planned for us all to have before the creation of the world, or face eternal death, that is everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. The Bible doesn't appear to present any other options for us. So it's either you'll be destroyed forever or you enjoy eternal life in Christ. And so now that we have the opportunity to make the decision, let us choose life, because there's no middle ground, okay? So we move straight to Tuesday. We talked about life and good, death and evil, blessings and curses. And we are going to read Deuteronomy 30 verses 15 to 20. See, I have set before you today life and good, death and evil, in that I command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in his ways, and to keep his commandments, his statutes, and his judgments, that you may live and multiply, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land which you go to possess. But if your heart turns away so that you do not hear, and are drawn away, and worship other gods, and serve them, I announce to you today that you shall surely perish. You shall not prolong your days in the land which you cross over the Jordan to go in and possess. I call heaven and earth as witnesses today against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore choose life, that both you and your descendants may live, that you may love the Lord your God, that you may obey his voice, and that you may cling to him, for he is your life and the length of your days, and that you may dwell in the land which the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give them. Amen. God is our life, and the Bible stresses it. Moses said, for it's your length of life, or for it's your long of life. And so our existence, our life, everything is in God. And he says, choose good, because that is where your life is. You get it? He said before us, life and good, death and evil, blessings and curses. And he's teaching us to choose life, to choose blessings, to choose what is right before God, so that we will enjoy eternal life. There is no middle ground. Here, as all through the Bible, there is no middle ground, no neutral place to be. They will either serve the Lord and have life, or they will choose death. It's the same for us as well. It was the same for Adam and Eve, the same for the Israelites, and the same for us. God is always placing something before us, two things. Either you choose life, and enjoy it, or you choose sin and enjoy death. I don't know if you can enjoy death. Life, goodness, blessing, in contrast to what? Death, evil, and curses. In the end, though one justly could argue that God really offers them only the good, only life, and only blessings. But if they turn away from him, these bad things will be the natural result because they no longer have his special protection. That is it. And so when we choose to obey God, we are always under his protective arms. He's always covering us with his wings, protecting us from evil. But the moment you choose to obey Satan, you cannot continue enjoying that protection. In fact, you cannot stay in Ghana and be enjoying privileges from US. It doesn't work like that, no. And so it's either you are on the side of God or on the side of Satan. It seems so obvious what the correct choice would be, doesn't it? And yet we know what happened. The great controversy was as real then as it is now. And we should learn from Israel's example what can happen if we don't give ourselves wholly to the Lord and choose life and all that this choice entails. And so we have enough example before us to choose life so that we can enjoy it forever. The great controversy is still ongoing, but Christ has assured us that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. So if only we will trust in God to strengthen us, then we will choose life and enjoy eternal life. When Isaiah talks about not too hard for you, not too hard for you. Deuteronomy 30 opens with the Lord telling his people what would happen if they repent and turned away from their evil ways. What wonderful promises were offered them too. And so we are going to look at the other wonderful promises God offered his people. And we are going to read few verses of Deuteronomy 30 verse 1 to 10. Now it shall come to pass, when all these things come upon you, the blessing and the curse which I have set before you, and you call them to mind among all the nations where the Lord your God drives you, and you return to the Lord your God and obey his voice according to all that I command you today, you and your children, with all your heart and with all your soul, that the Lord your God will bring you back from captivity, have compassion on you, and gather you again from all the nations where the Lord your God has scattered you. If any of you are driven out of the farthest part under heaven, from there the Lord your God will gather you, and from there he will bring you. Then the Lord your God will bring you to the land which your fathers possessed, and you shall possess it. He will prosper you and multiply you more than your fathers. And the Lord your God will circumcise your heart and the heart of your descendants to love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, that you may live. Also, the Lord your God will put all these curses on your enemies and on those who hate you, who persecuted you, and you will again obey the voice of the Lord and do all his commandments which I command you today. The Lord your God will make you abound in all the work of your hand, in the fruit of your body, in the increase of your livestock, and in the produce of your land for God. For the Lord will again rejoice over you for good as he rejoiced over your fathers, if you obey the voice of the Lord your God to keep his commandments and his statutes, which are written in this book of the law, and if you turn to the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. Amen. So I read everything and I couldn't stop reading because the promises were too sweet. So I have to read everything. So God here is telling us, if we choose life, all these blessings will come upon us. And that is what he told Israel. That would certainly have been comforting to hear. However, the point was not that it didn't matter if they turned away from what God had commanded. The Lord doesn't offer anyone cheap grace. If anything, it should have shown them God's love, and thus, as a response, they would love him back, revealing their love by being obedient to what he told them to do. And so some of us, we think that we can choose to do whatever we want and still enjoy the grace and mercies and the blessings of God. No, God doesn't offer us cheap grace. And so just as he told the Israelites, if you choose to obey me and remember all the things I have done for you, I am going to deliver you, I'm going to bless you, and those who persecuted you, I'm going to send all these curses on them. But if you choose not to obey, I mean, you cannot keep on enjoying those blessings. And what God is requiring from them is not something so easy or something difficult. What God is asking us, the principles he set before us, they are not difficult. They are not something so far away from us. And so when we read Deuteronomy 30 verse 11 to 40, it says that what I said before you is not something that is in heaven that you need someone to bring it, or something that is beyond the sea. It is something within your reach, something that is before you. I'm not giving you something so difficult to do. I'm just asking you to choose life, choose to be on my side. That is what God is asking us to do. Look at the appeal here with its beautiful language and airtight logic. The Lord is not asking of them anything too hard to do. God's command is not too difficult or mysterious for them to understand, nor is it too far out of their reach to attain. It's not way up in heaven, so far away that someone else has to get it for them, nor is it across the seas, so someone else must bring it to them. Instead, the Lord says, "But the word is very near you, in your mouth and in your heart, that you may do it." Deuteronomy 34 says the word is very near you, it's in your heart, because God says, now I'm going to write it upon your heart. You don't need someone to come and tell you before you know. All the time God speaks to our heart, our conscience, our senses, and he keeps on urging us to choose what is right, to choose life. Not just any life, but life that is based on him. Thursday talks about a question of worship, a question of worship. Central to the covenant relationship between the Lord and Israel was worship. What made the Israelites different from all the world around them was that they alone as a nation were worshiping the true God, as opposed to the false gods and goddesses of the pagan world, which were really no gods at all. Now see that I am he, and there is no God besides me. Deuteronomy 32 verse 39. Amen. So God doesn't share his glory, his worship with anyone. And so God, knowing that his people are going to live among people who don't know him, people who worship idols and other things, God had to question his people to be careful so that they don't end up worshiping those things, because he's the only one that we need to worship. When you read Deuteronomy 4 verse 19, it says, "And take heed, lest you lift your eyes to heaven, and when you see the sun, the moon, and the stars, all the host of heaven, you feel driven to worship them and serve them, which the Lord your God has given to all the peoples under the whole heaven as a heritage." And so God was telling Israel, take heed, be careful. You don't end up worshiping the sun, the moon, the sea, and the things that I have given to humanity. You don't need to worship those things. I created them. I deserve to be worshipped. And so that is what God is much concerned about, whom we give our allegiance to. Our God is a jealous God, and he alone, as our creator and redeemer, is worthy of our worship. Here too, there is no middle ground. We either worship the Lord who brings life, goodness, and blessings, or we worship any other God which brings evil, curses, and death. And so it's either you are worshiping the creator or you are worshiping something else which will lead you toward to death. The beautiful thing is that the God we worship created us, but they are gods, they created them. You see? And so why not worship what created you instead of worshiping what you did with your own hands? They are gods. Pick the clay, the wood, and carve them into the image they want and they worship. But we are God created us in his own image. And so he alone we need to worship. However different the context, the issue is the same. Will people worship the true God and have life, or will they succumb to the pressures, either overt or subtle or both, to turn their allegiance away from him and face death. Ultimately, the answer lies within each individual heart. God did not force ancient Israel to follow him, and he won't force us. And so God will not force anyone to follow him. We have to willingly choose to worship God. So God will not force you. What he will do is he will speak to your heart. He will keep on talking to your conscience, but the decision will still lie in your hands. It doesn't matter how subtle it is or how serious it is. God always wants us to choose him over and over again. We are concluding the lesson with something from the Friday lesson. Sister White, The Great Controversy, page 544. It says, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Romans 6:23. While life is the inheritance of the righteous, death is the portion of the wicked. Moses declared to Israel, I have set before thee this day life and good, and death and evil. Deuteronomy 30:15. The death referred to in these scriptures is not that pronounced upon Adam, for all mankind suffered the penalty of his transgression. It is the second death that is placed in contrast with everlasting life. Amen. And so the death God is talking about here, the Bible is talking about, it's not the death that we all face. As for this death, whether righteous or sinner or sinful person, we will all die. But the second death, when Christ will come in his glory and bring his judgment, where some of us will enjoy eternal life, then others who chose not to obey will enjoy everlasting destruction. And I don't know whether that one you can call it enjoyment, but hey, that can never be enjoyment. So the lesson is admonishing us to choose life, not just any life, but life that is based on God. Thanks so much for being part of today's summary. If you have not yet subscribed, please consider subscribing, like and share this video. You might touch a heart out there by just sharing this video. Have a blessed life. Bye bye.